Terra Mystica is more addictive than crack. There, I said it. I've never gotten so immediately hooked to a game since I started playing poker, and that's saying something since poker is literally designed to be addictive. Unlike poker though, explaining the appeal of this Euro-style resource management board game can be kinda tough since it has so much going for it. What I haven't heard many people articulate though is the single greatest reason that this game carries with it one of the fastest growing online competitive scenes, along with one of the most devoted fanbases out there. Because in all seriousness, the main reason that Terra Mystica is so beloved and so popular is, drumroll please, because of this little building. As seemingly banal as it seems, any high-level Terra player knows that this little dude basically carries this absolute marvel of a board game, and is one of the essential game design choices that makes Terra Mystica one of the most engaging and fulfilling multiplayer experiences out there. That's right, trading houses are the number one reason why you should play Terra Mystica, and I'm here to explain why. By the way, whether you know absolutely nothing about this game or if you're a seasoned veteran, this video is meant to be accessible for all, so don't worry if you don't even know all the rules. That said, this video isn't a synopsis of the rules or a game guide, and more so an analysis of the intricacies of Terra Mystica's design philosophy. For those of you who have never played, I left you a video in the description that you can watch later so that you can be filled in on all the nuances of the game rules. Alrighty, so with that out of the way, there are three major reasons that trading houses, also sometimes called trading posts for some reason, are an absolute marvel of game design. In Terra Mystica, the player who gets the most points wins the game, and one way to score points is to spread your buildings all over this big lovely map. The way you're gonna do this is by using the simplest buildings in the game, dwellings. Dwellings are small buildings that are pretty cheap to build, and act as a sort of level one building that you can upgrade to bigger things, like temples, sanctuaries, and strongholds, which are more expensive and serve a variety of different purposes. What's important to note is that these buildings are priced consistently throughout the game. So, for example, the Witch faction always pays 1 worker and 2 coins to build a dwelling, 2 workers and 5 coins to build a temple, etc, etc. Trading houses, on the other hand, are super weird relative to these other buildings, though, because trading houses always cost fewer coins when you have adjacent neighbors wherever you're building them. Since coins are the scarcest resource in the game, you'll need to save every last one that you can, meaning that in advanced play, you almost always want to build these buildings exclusively wherever you have an adjacent opponent. While dwellings are your level 1 buildings, trading houses are the level 2 buildings that are mandatory to leveling up to the really big stuff. The fact that you save a ton of coins when building adjacent to an opponent all but forces proximity in your building habits and ultimately encourages aggression between players, since you're more likely to cut someone off if you're right next to them. This is particularly brilliant because games like Terra Mystica would otherwise encourage as little player interaction as possible, since you'd normally be tempted to stay far away from people to avoid getting interrupted on your glorious trail. To see what I mean by this, let's take a look at another area control slash resource management game, Catan. Yeah, you know it, the one with the sheep and the wheat, the rocks. The way that you win Catan is to build lots of buildings, have the strongest army, or create the longest network, which is actually very similar to Terra Mystica in terms of how you win the game, but instead of having the longest army, you want to be the highest on cult tracks. Where Terra Mystica and Catan differ is that Catan is designed in a way that your connection is pretty tenuous if you're set up too close to an opposing player. This makes it so that at top level Catan, you'll usually find yourself building outward, toward the edges of the board, so that you have as few interruptions as possible. Add the fact that the game has an out to trading with people due to the harbor mechanic, and you're left with a setup in which you're actively trying to avoid playing the game with other players, while trying to remain as isolated and solitary as humanly possible. As I mentioned in my Fixing Chaotic video, which is a super dope video that you should all check out by the way, good multiplayer games make you feel like there's a back and forth dynamic between you and your opponents, that your actions can influence theirs and vice versa. This is why competitive Catan is kind of an oxymoron, as even the most optimistic Catan players admit that choosing your starting position is at least half of the strategic element to the game.
Possibly. And we're starting here with some early placements. Obviously, some say 70% of the game is the placement.
Oh, I would say more like 50 or 60.
But I don't know. It's quite a lot.
Terra Mystica, on the other hand, strongly encourages players to cut each other off by incentivizing their proximity to one another. Again, unless you want to pay a ton of your precious coins for trading houses, you need to have many of your dwellings be adjacent to your opponent's buildings. What's more is that this game is designed around giving you several outs should your connection path be interrupted by an opponent, meaning that you don't feel like it's a game over just because your opponent takes away one of your desired hexes. This one building makes for an experience in which you constantly have to keep an eye out for what your opponents are capable of pulling, and leads to a much more tense back and forth dynamic between players. While similar looking on the surface, Catan often feels more like a game of checkers, whereas Terra Mystica feels a hell of a lot more like four-player chess. Oof, okay, so I've spent a lot of time talking about how trading houses incentivize more interactive play between participants, but I've yet to dive into what really makes trading posts worth building in the first place, aside from the fact that they let you level up to bigger and better things down the road. Trading posts have numerous other uses in the game, though, and one of their more idiosyncratic properties is the fact that they are the earliest building in the game that is worth 2 magic power, and that makes them very special. You see, when an opponent builds something next to one of your buildings in Terra Mystica, you can choose to gain magic power at the cost of some of your points. Magic power is a very important resource, and there aren't many ways to get it, so much so that you'll find advanced players typically accepting this power bonus almost all the time in the early to mid game. Here's the thing though, the amount of power that you gain is dependent on the power value of the structure that your opponent is building next to. So if your opponent is, let's say, building next to a dwelling, then you won't get too much magic power. However, if he's building next to one of your trade posts, you get double the magic power that you'd usually get from a dwelling. Trading houses are the cheapest building that gets you 2 magic power, so advanced play requires that you're hyper-cognizant of where your opponents are thinking of traveling and upgrading, so that you can be close by with a trading house wherever they do. Novice players often end up throwing themselves way too far away from neighbors because they're afraid of getting boxed in. But this mentality is actually super counterintuitive in Terra Mystica, given that you miss out on the massive power bonuses that you get from neighbors. My poor buddy Johnny, for example, falls into this trap every single time we play, and always seems to start in the damn corner with the witches. Stop doing it, Johnny! I'll find you! I'll find where you live! Stop starting in the corner! Trading houses having a high power level is also useful for another mechanic in Terra Mystica. Towns. Towns are made by having 4 adjacent buildings with a total power level of 7 or more, and just straight up give you resources or a ton of points whenever you make them. Remember when I mentioned that you're incentivized to spread around the map to get more points? Well, depending on which faction you choose, there are certain hexes that are easier to build on than others, which means that you'd normally gravitate to just throwing dwellings on those that are easy to build upon. That said, the ability to make towns encourages you to centralize your higher power buildings sometimes, meaning that you need to pick your spots for trading posts very carefully to facilitate making towns. This makes for a more creative element to the gameplay, as sometimes you can choose to go for the longest road, whereas other times you might want to forego longest road and just try getting a third town out instead. The creative choices in Terra Mystica are crazy for this reason, and trading houses are the very backbone of the entire system. Okay, so back to me shitting on Catan. What can I say? It's my second favorite pastime, aside from spanking noobs on ranked with cultists, of course. Unlike Monopoly, where your only resource is money, Catan makes it so that there are a few different types of resources. Brick, wheat, wood, sheep, and fucking rocks! Here's the thing though, rocks and wheat are bar none the most important resources in the game because when the board gets all cluttered, making cities becomes the best way to accumulate points. So your general building order in Catan is usually quite predictable and gets very dry quickly, even at top level. Terra Mystica, on the other hand, isn't so simple with its building order, and is actually one of the most complex facets of the game at top level. Anytime you build a structure, you pay the cost, and then every time you pass your turn, you get whatever resources are indicated under the structure. As such, along with letting you get better buildings in the long run, trading houses typically get you 2 coins and some magic power. There's a top Terra player named Zoras who has a great video going further into depth on the economy of the game, but to summarize his points, 2 coins and some power isn't going to compensate you for the cost of a trading house, even at the cheapest price, especially given the opportunity cost of also losing out on the dwelling income once you slap the dwelling back into place on your player board.
Oh yeah, that happens when you build trading posts, by the way.
So if trading houses don't offer a net gain in resources, then what do they offer? Well, let's flash back to when I was talking about the importance of coins. Since coins are the scarcest resource in the game, you'll need to save every last one that you can. Again, unless you want to pay a ton of your precious coins for trading houses, you need to have many of your dwellings be adjacent to your opponent's buildings. As that sexy voice from the past just suggested, trade posts may not offer you a straight-up guaranteed benefit like the cities in Catan, but they do allow for your economy to become more diversified rather than merely expanded upon. The end result of this situation is a building that seems super expensive and unrewarding at first glance, but is pivotal to your accumulation of the single most important resource in the game. Any advanced player knows that the real question in Terra Mystica isn't whether or not to build trading posts, but rather when and where to build them. The totality of this means that the placement of your trading houses is a highly tactical one. You not only want to build next to a neighbor because it's cheaper, and in places that you know will contribute to towns, but you also want to build at times in which they score you points and also provide you with a much-needed source of coin income. Terra Mystica has so much going for it, such as the diversity of having 14 entirely unique races to choose from, like dwarves and giants and engineers? I thought that was a profession, but okay. There's also the fact that no two games are ever the same because of the fact that the scoring rounds and bonus tiles are chosen at random, keeping each new game fresh and exciting. There's also the fact that while it takes time getting used to the game's iconography, the game is super accessible compared to something like chess or, heaven forbid, Go, and the meta is still heavily developing even as I speak, meaning that there's never been a better time to get into the game thanks to resources like BoardGameArena.com. In conclusion, if you're looking for a strategy-driven experience that tests your ability to foresee what you and your opponent's resources will look like down the line, while also taking part in one of the most aggressive and competitive grinds out there, with a high but rewarding skill ceiling, then Terra Mystica is the game for you. Also, while I would usually plug myself at the end of a video, I'm gonna actually suggest that you guys go subscribe to Zoras, because somehow he has less subs than me? What the fuck, Terra Mystica community? Seriously, go sub to him. Also, subscribe to the Fire 2 tournaments, because they've got some super high-level stuff going on, and at the time of recording this, there's some really, really cool games with lots and lots of upsets. Like, oh my god, Fire 2, thank you guys for organizing tournaments. You guys are dope. Yeah, Terra Mystica for life.
Deuces!